I suppose I'll just start with this basic description that within the show there are perhaps four distinct areas. There's the group of sea ghost paintings, there's the Nobody Spoke collection of chairs with the microphones and other paraphernalia around it. There are the series of drawings, which is a selection from a much larger sequence. And then there is a series of portraits, which are text-based within vitrines. I wonder if I could just start by asking you a little about the sea ghost works, which are quite complex visually. They have complex surfaces. There are lots of marks, which are both brush marks and signs of brush marks. There's drawing which suggests substance, although they're very flat. But there are also slivers, rectilinear slivers, which reproduce different aspects of other works. And there is also, in a sense, a reference back to another series of works that look quite like that, some of the hostage paintings that you showed, I think, at the Lisson, perhaps towards the end of the 1980s. So there's a sort of question about a relationship to a past, which is to say your past. And perhaps you could say a little bit about what kind of relationship that is that you're trying to deal with in works like that.
Specifically the painting?
Yes, those paintings, yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Well, just to perhaps set a scene related to these, the title they have is an anagram of hostages. So perhaps they're anagrams, in a sense, of the earlier things which were called hostages. If an anagram is merely, you know, is something like shifting bits of a word or signifier around to make something else. The strips and inserts in these paintings advert both to a series of works he did in the 1980s called the Incidents in a Museum, and to the contents of the 17 chairs in the other room. They are, as it were, side-on views of those chairs with the frontal surfaces, as it were, transposed to the silhouette. The painted bit, the sort of messy, brush-strokey bit, does indeed recall the hostage series of the 1980s, which were inspired in part by a painting by Camille Pizarro on a palette, in which he, as it were, sought to demonstrate the divisionistic technique. What struck us in the 80s was that sense in which one could, so to speak, turn a painting inside out. So he had turned the whole idea of the painting as being something which, as it were, reached some fully complete condition, and the sort of workings out were in some way lost or irrelevant to its aesthetic, to one's aesthetic understanding of it, that he'd actually sort of put them side by side. It struck us later that these works were radically uncompletable, that there is no formal, very strong formal reason why you would stop dabbing away. So in one sense or another, you might complete them until they, as it were, filled the room three-dimensionally. There'd be no powerful reason in principle way to stop. Of course, there is a reason, and that reason might be attached to some set of observances as to certain sorts of modernistic aesthetic principles, some sort of other considerations, which would be in part instinct within us, that is to say, we would have some formal tastes, intentions, and so on, and furthermore would be a kind of imposture in us, be both. So in one sense or another, these paintings are performances of painting, as were the original hostages. We were, as it were, occupying the bodies of painters, or the minds of painters in part, like spectres. The inserts, which referred back to the incidents in the museum, are composed of two elements, actually. They refer to the incidents in the museum, which is a little cipher of the fact that at that time we began to realize that the site of artistic production had shifted from the studio to the light, to the place of its consumption and distribution and its corporate entity. And so to speak, as a little way of reminding ourselves of that, we had in the original hostage painting of the 80s, we inserted that sort of reference to the museum in a curious combination, which was the redescription, recapitulation of the four-letter word SURF, S-U-R-F, which had been associated with work of the 1970s. We transformed that SURF element into an adaptation of the plan of a museum. So it's a floor plan, reconfigured to a degree to say an S, but a very slight adjustment. So they're pretty daft looking SURFs, but nevertheless reconstructed. Similarly, the present items also, they don't say SURF, but they do. They are based upon the plans of sundry museums, including the Museum of Temporary Art in Barcelona, because we've had to deal with a lot of plans from Museum of Temporary Art in Barcelona this year. And it's all lying around the studio. So the chair profiles have, as it were, been perverted into recollections of this museum plan. So we have then the signs of completion, as it were. But these are very, what do you call it, evanescent, rather weak signs of completion, the little shadows. They're not heavily painted, they're very quiet, and they look as if they're produced, and they have been produced, not with a brush, as in painting, but with a pen, as in writing. Mm-hmm. So we have this sort of weak completion of an uncompletable painting, which at the same time also refers to the notion that the site of the production of paintings is in some way in the light, and that therefore, in one sense or another, these are performances of painting produced in the dark, which nevertheless find themselves inconveniently and embarrassingly transformed to a circumstance where they're seen in public and in the light. That's what I do so far. Go on, Mel.
After that. Well, I did think of several things to say, but I think it was about 10 minutes ago.
Sorry.
It's all right. That's all.
Sorry, it was only a paragraph.
Only a paragraph. It's okay. I guess the show has... The origins of the show really starts with the drawings. And then Michael said, we've got these drawings, let's make some chairs out of these drawings. So we had to make... We made 147 drawings, so that was almost 17 chairs. And then we were going to make the drawings into the chairs, and I thought that was really quite an interesting thing to do. And then Michael wanted to deface the drawings of the chairs, which I thought was a really shit idea. But it turned out that it actually was quite interesting, because it really... The trouble with... I think what we do is we tend to do paintings and then do things on the paintings and then do things with the paintings. So it all gets very discursively unstable. And then He also said we should do these hostage paintings. Now, hostage paintings, when we first did the hostage palette paintings, I found them very, very difficult to do because they were a kind of performance, they were a kind of acting, they were a kind of doing gooey abstract paintings, which is not, as it were, our taste. So it was, they were tough things to do and tough things to know how to finish. And I think Michael just described how we actually came to finish these was by almost making a kind of little depiction of the palette. Because the palette's quite a difficult thing to represent. What's a palette look like? There's all sorts of palettes. When do you decide the palette's all right? Is there such a decision? Is there such a thing that you can know when to stop? So I think the shadows made that. But I think the whole show has a kind of, has it starts in a way from the drawings, leads through to the paintings, and it's actually a long time since Michael and I did any paintings, except paintings like portraits of George W. Bush in the style of Jackson Pollock. We've managed to do those recently. But I was frankly amazed that we actually managed to do these paintings. You could put them on the wall, you could look at them, and they looked okay.
But the palette, I should say, is also sort of hackneyed sign of art.
Yeah, it's a sign of art. It's a sign of the production of art.
In the Rue Seine in Paris is a very nice restaurant, you know, patronized by Régis Debray and so-called La Palette, that we used to frequent a lot.
And they had
dreadful kind of kitschy palettes all over the wall. So we're sort of also tapping in slightly to that really stupid sense of it being a sign of art.
So just to look at one little aspect of the things that you've been talking about there, this question of, well, darkness and light, you're talking about, mm-hmm. things maybe that are made in darkness that are brought into light, mm-hmm. things that happen in the light, mm-hmm. Things that are drawn, which then become canvases, which then become chairs, which are to be looked at, and I mean almost, I mean not quite in the same way, but in the sense that one's dealing with incompletability, as it were. In the paintings, the chairs are unsit-down-on-able. They can't be used, except they are chairs. So there's a kind of a mixing up of sort of spatial senses and spatial identities. The studio, where something maybe happens, the gallery, where something happens. Does the same kind of thing happen in these two spaces? The domestic space, which is perhaps also figured in the idea of the chair. Mm-hmm. The question about how objects are distributed in these places. And then also that you're using specifically black and white in those drawings and in the mm-hmm. paintings of the chairs. How much are we dealing with, as it were, things which are this and then that, this leading to that, and how much are you actually very actively trying to screw that up and say there is no simple division in these terms? Where are things being made? This kind of darkness and light that I'm kind of...
Well, not making things in the light, meaning not making things in an institutional context, we've always considered to be quite important. We need to be able to fuck up. We need to make mistakes. Yeah. We need to learn from those mistakes. Learn from our mistakes. But we need to learn from the mistakes of how to do things differently, and that's what we do. We do it in the studio because we can't do it in the institution. But there is an aspect of the work that, I mean, this is an old thing of good old Marcel Duchamp, where the viewer comes in and the viewer adds their own detail to the work. So in a way the work is made in the studio, but it also has a distinct life in the institution because of the way you recover detail. And I think our work has always been important to be able to recover detail. In fact, some of it's just detail, if there is such a thing as just detail at all. We're finished.
The dark white business is I mean the one of the perhaps more intriguing aspects of the art produced in the light is a lot surrounds that fact. The corporatism of the press, the aesthetic corporatism of the press, the fact that, you know, rather, notwithstanding, you know, relational aesthetics and so on, that actually we operate at a time which is a bit like, I mean, it has this sense that it's like Robert Musil's, like the Vienna of Robert Musil's Man Without Qualities, that it's the perfect illusion, that we've been told that in global conceptual art, or whatever you call it, there's all these networks, infrastructures and so on operating. But in fact, what's happening is that, as Matthew Jesse Jackson describes it, some, you know, a legion of curators with Twitter feeds are actually the management that's presiding over the production. And in that circumstance of management, for the artist, the possibility of failure is in a sense ruled out in principle by that system. So one of the ways it seems to us that such a world might be resisted, and we've been trying to resist it for the last 40 years or so, that emergence of the manager as the artist's not boon companion or enabler, but actually substitute. You know. But we've sought to retain a degree of privacy and need to work in the dark. In the dark, one can make work which to a degree has a some power of self-destruction. It could fail even in public, in a certain sense. Mm. And the business of making things as, you know, one thing becoming another thing, and so there's various transformations. I think Mel mentioned Duchamp, but there's also that question of, and I think it's an exceedingly powerful idea, not properly theorized by sort of curatorial consumers, that idea of Roland Barthes, of the, what he's talking about, the writerly reader. In fact, he's kind of bullshitting about it, really, Barthes himself, because he's so utterly enthralled, I mean, so utterly respectful, indeed almost religious about Proust, that he can't quite bring himself to do it, but even though he's recommending it, but we certainly are recommending it. Finish, complete the work. The infrastructure invites the viewer
to pick up on that. Because there's when you talk about the way in which you first came to make chairs out of your canvases, you talk about sort of putting them up on the wall and seeing some sort of fairly rigid grid, and somehow it didn't do it, as it was. So you then made them into chairs which looked like other things, but then also require, almost demand, that whoever is looking quite consciously understand that what's happening is that they are adopting, they need to adopt a perspective, they need to have a viewpoint, which is to say also a point of view on whatever detail of the thing it is that they're looking at. And quite often you're referring to the idea of viewing as intrusive, as something that's actually breaking into or erupting into this space that you have have constructed. Could you say something about that idea of intrusion and to go on from that?
Well, it's really what I was just trying to say, that it gives you an opportunity to make recover detail and make your own detail. And when we first did the chair, the small canvases with the art language thing, issues silk screened on canvas, and we put them on the wall in a grid, we didn't have any problem. You just stood there and you looked at it, and it rather defeated the whole notion of actually being intrusive. And we've made things that are kind of intrusive by putting plywood over painting and drilling holes in them so that you had to look at the painting through the holes, We've done other paintings based on Courbet's Origine du Monde, where you had glass, where you had to, in a way, almost make a film of yourself looking at the picture. You had to move around, you had to try and recover detail. I think it's just basically in the recovery of detail that we somehow wish to reanimate the work.
Which it's is doing, doing work on the work.
Work on the work, yeah.
Inevitably intrusive, because the danger is you're going to obliterate the work in some sense or another in this infrastructural implication.
So who it is who does that, what kind of viewer bothers to do that, I don't know. I mean, whether it's not something you can measure, but you can't say he successfully recovered detail, but she hasn't, or vice versa, because there are very, very many ways that you can recover the detail, excuse me.
Yeah.
The thing about the chairs, too, which I suppose is worth mentioning, is that as a quasi-domestic object, and they're certainly not sculptures, you know, pretty sure about that, there is a sense in which, as objects of domestication, one's regard on a chair, which to a degree implies a person occupying that chair, one's regard is in itself perhaps necessarily intrusive, as much as one is looking upon a person who may not return, an implied person who may not return one's regard. Furthermore, we speculated when we first produced this sort of furniture, in one way or another. We speculated, not to any great purpose, but nevertheless with some amusement, as to whether, in fact, the emergent author of these works had changed gender. In fact, we concluded that it may be the author emergent from our activity was in fact a woman, to which Mel added the observation, a difficult woman. This spectral woman is in one way or another presiding over these sort of homeless objects, even though, I mean, they're homeless because she's spectral. It really are. But we produced, one way or another, by this means and others, a funny sort of dialogue with the idea of detail and the idea that the object upon which that detail is present is homeless in some sense, and it is necessarily homeless because it requires further work, further activity, if you like, Bachtian writerliness on the part of the
and it's homeless because, as it were, it always is homeless. These things always are homeless, or because the work that you're doing is, in some sense, a kind of continual process of eviction. Something like that.
That's a very good way to describe it. A continual process of eviction is an excellent way to.
I guess we've been working and we've collaborated with people on and off for many, many years, but the emergent author, which we make together, being a woman, we've finally invented an imaginary friend. But I think that this homeless...
So heterosexual pateres familiae.
I think that the art world is completely drenched in public relations. I mean, Joanna told me that when she was at Frieze, that the Pace Gallery had women on the stand who looked like supermodels. And I think it's completely drenched in a kind of public relations and a public relations language. And the artists know exactly who they're working for, the artists who work in the light. And I think it's been characteristic of art and language work ever since it began, that it never quite knew who its audience was. Its audience was your mates or your friend or your collaborator. It never really knew who it was. And I think that's really quite an interesting thing, because you never know. And we still don't know quite who the audience is for this kind of work, or what they may bring to it. We don't know.
And I think this...
That's homelessness.
Yes. And the question about detail, or whether one is forced to confront the need to deal with detail, or whether one finds strategies to avoid that. I mean, you mentioned relational aesthetics, and I kind of have this sense that very often what people might want to do in the face of your work is to find ways to give it a home, as it were. Say, oh, this is a bit like that. So when you talk about infrastructure, you know, people can make a reference to a probably not quite so recent essay by David Joselit now about, you know, painting's transitivity, and which he will go back as far as maybe Martin Kippenberger in grounding, but obviously it's further back. And when you're talking about the chairs not being furniture, you know, how do we negotiate that in relation to a term like three-dimensional work, for example?
Well, there was,
but they are drawings.
Going back to long, long ago, Robert Morris, insisting that what he was making were objects, not really sculpture, notes on sculpture, that makes a distinction between what might be seen in frolicking I-beams and what he called sculpture, what he called object. We rather insist on the not being conceived as sculpture, because if they are sculpture, they're pretty shitty, poor sculpture indeed. They are not so much in a state of being constructive as chairs as being dismantled from a grid on the wall and put into the form of a chair. It is, as it were, a kind of, you know, construction as dismantling rather than anything. Mm. So, I mean, for that reason alone, I would say that they, you know, they ain't sculptures.
Yeah. And we could go on to the performance in and around these works, which is, again, another whole series of layers, as you were talking about, Mel. You know, there's a text which you have made. It involves characters, three characters, A, B, and C. Perhaps maybe A and B are you, maybe they're you, but then there's C. So is C this ghost, this phantom that you're talking about? Is this someone else? Is it a very ambiguous, multifaceted other person? The text is read and recorded by people who are not actors, but then it is mimed to by people who definitely are actors. And in one sense, they're not speaking the lines, but of course, insofar as they are acting, they are very definitely active within the transmission of this text, which is all, you know, about this question of what the works are, how one describes them, how one deals with them. And then towards the end, one of the characters, as it were, does some work on these things by also redescribing them, redistributing them, which is a very active physical thing. He literally gets the saw out and then crowbars the thing apart and turns it over and so on. So is that another kind of intrusion that we're dealing with here?
Yes, I think it's an intrusion, because it's sort of making another work, and it's also a kind, it's also fiction in a certain sense too. You know, the sense in which if you produce in the dark, you know, one of the things, I mean, as everyone knows, I mean, going back to the painting, is full of imposture. Artistic practice is intrinsically, you know, bounded by a kind of founded on a kind of imposture of a kind. As someone here present actually will attest, I mean, part of the Graham Howe is so present. You know, art language was one of its abiding principles early on was involved with a critique of the stereotypes of artistic personality and all the other ramifications thereof. But the text of the Jackson Pollock by performance is perhaps in part a first order sort of attempt to account for the work, and at the same time an operation of a second or third or fourth order, a redescriptive thing, which sets up certain sort of possibilities for accounting for the work rather than accounting for the work in some sort of defensive sort of way. It rather sort of explodes the work a little. And the character that is C, I mean, there used to be ABC, didn't there, on the stage. They had four more actors often, because we used to write a part for Charlie, Charles Harrison, who's no longer with us. So now A and B is maybe, me and Mel, maybe not. The voice off, the sort of intruder, or the objectionable character. Mm. I mean, I thought was actually in this present performance was brilliant, didn't you? Because they found a guy from Dallas who got that sort of snarky voice of a kind of, I was like, smart-assed American philosophy professor. That's what you want to punch. and the actor, the bearded actor, also had the aspect of that sort of philosophy professor. It was actually quite, I found it quite stirring, actually, that this guy I really hated, you know, reading lines that we'd written. It was a very strange kind of, inversion of the situation. But we operated with, in various ways, with the Jackson Pollock Bar. We've done, for example, interviews, scripted interviews with critics. A critic called Carlos Guerra, Spanish critic, which is again was a fictional interview. Which again, we create circumstances in which we appear to make, a la Rousseau, make confessions which are actually fictional accounts, giving some sort of fiction account of ourselves, but also sort of hacking into our own work by doing it.
I was just listening. But we've done the Jackson Pollock Bar. We've been working with maybe everyone knows this. I don't know. Nobody knows this. We've been working with the Jackson Pollock Bar since 1995, on and off with things, and they've done Art and Language Paints a Picture, which it was a very old script of ours, where they actually the actors actually try to paint a picture. Wasn't very good. It's okay. I believe it's in the Tate. We did Art and Language Scenes of Song.
It's better than our attempts to reconstruct
it. Yes, we tried to reconstruct the actors painting. Boy, oh boy. And we actually managed to make a painting, what was it, 6 foot by 12 foot, after the actor's painting, and it was only good when we cut the whole thing up and made paper chains out of it. So we do kind of try and rescue our bummers sometimes. But I've always found the Jackson Pollock Bar performances riveting in themselves, in the sense that they have that same kind of detail. Because when you're looking at someone mime something, and mime, they used to light cigarettes and so on, pick a glass of water up, the soundtrack never quite it matches. It's impossible to do it properly. So there's always a kind of recovery of that kind of those little accidents which makes other kinds of details. So we're not just interested in the Jackson Pollock Bar performance as an adjunct to our work. We're also interested, quite convinced by the way the Jackson Pollock Bar do their theory installations.
Yeah, they also produce a sort of active verfremdungs effect, as it were, for an alienation on
I suppose it's late enough in the proceeding to mention Walter Benjamin. I do apologize.
He's been standing in the corner, itching for an introduction.
But in the task of the translator, which is, I think, lovely text of his. He discusses what a translation can be, and one of the things that he kind of gets quite wound up and interested about is the idea that it might be a betrayal. Well, what's a betrayal in translation? A misconstrual, deliberate misconstrual, a perversion, distortion. It's a whole range of things. It's a turning an expression into its other in some sense or another. Now, in redescription, one has all or many of the possibilities that translation implies. So I suppose that's much, it's a question of you could ask, for example, whether completing or giving weak signs of completion to what begins as an uncompletable entity is a kind of betrayal of it, a kind of selling it down the river in some sort of weak way, and so on. So, I mean, these are all, I think, many of these forms of betrayal are rather intriguing in terms of how weak, strong, complete, paradoxical, and so on they are. But I mean, I think inevitably, as artists, we're bound to face those conditions. I think any art that's any good, to a degree, is always confronting those sorts of possibilities of self-betrayal. I mean, a good example in our own activity is that while we get involved in building all these infrastructures in the world, from Red Crayola Records to Jackson Pollock performances to fictional historical positions, fictional interviews, and moments like this, for want of a better example, we therefore acknowledge our part in the growth and development of the mighty Wurlitzer, the Gesamtkunstwerk, the postmodern art has become, or post-Duchampian dispensation has become. At the same time, one of the questions that intrigues us is, and seems increasingly necessary, as an intellectual task, and indeed a practical one that people have got to get to grips with at some point, is how to return to some semblance of the autonomy, how to restore some semblance of, some equivalent, some analog, whatever it is, of autonomy, because otherwise this Musil-like perfect illusion is going to have us all drift off into a kind of heat death. Things are going to get flatter and flatter, yeah. And there's going to be less and less difference. And there's a paradox there. I mean, building all these infrastructures and alleging at the same time that one is interested in the intellectual question of the restoration of a kind of autonomy for the work of art is, potentially fatal, a betrayal the one of the other. But, it seems nevertheless to be what, as far as I know, art of any substance usually faces those kinds of difficulties. That whole, what's his name, Zizek obsessed with, the Ulysses, trying to restore the hierarchy by pretending to destroy it. One's always, confronting these kinds of Hegelian fuck-ups.
Yeah, that is a strange thing, that we do seek to make some kind of autonomous work, but at the same time, it's constantly surrounded by these kind of infrastructures, and they both seem to happen at the same time. But maybe a lot of the things that Michael was talking about, betrayal and all the other things, which I can't remember, are in a way our materials. This is what we both use to make our work, which we fight against, and that's what makes the work, to some extent. And the infrastructures, the fact that the work goes out from itself and leads in other places, is not exactly autonomy, is it?
No.
So, but the modernist, I mean, modernism is something that our work has always been based on. We both admired it we're taught about it when we learnt about it when we were young, we knew about it. There's nothing like that whole modernist thing of putting something on the wall and saying, take it or leave it, there it is. You know, there's a kind of, it's no longer possible to do that kind of work, but somehow we're always constrained by it, or going toward it, or going away from it.
But what we have to say is also that the question becomes all the more interesting, because there is no possibility of a mere rappel à l'ordre. It's the very last thing we might be suggesting.
Yeah. I mean, one of the very kind of familiar words for some years now has been archives, working with an archive. And it seems to me that of all the things that you're doing, that's not what you're doing. You're not archiving yourselves. The idea that there might be three paintings in the museum and one in the restaurant is actually part of this thing of not saying, well, that's done and it's there. Mm-hmm. And the show that you've just got in Barcelona, which is coming out of a whole series of activities that you've been doing over the last few years, looking at work from the early sort of conceptual art days and saying, is this a document? Is this a work? Could it be both a document and a work at the same time? Mm. And does it therefore mean that whenever anyone is looking at this, there is almost inbuilt into this a sense that misunderstanding, misreading is going to take place, and it's that almost inevitability of the misreading that is the place where the work has to start?
Well, that's where the work was made in the first place, and it's not that that's a question that comes up later when we are now inevitably dealing with archival problems. Mm. But it was always a question that nobody in the early days of art and language, I believe, nobody quite knew where the work was. Nobody quite knew what it was. Sometimes you knew the work was there on the piece of paper, and sometimes you didn't know what exactly it was. And what or where it was going. And I think that the other thing is that it's all right to do that kind of work and retain the kind of stability of yourself as a professional artist. That is to say, the biological, authentic artist does conceptual art. I think what happened with art language is it broke down the authorship of the work as well. So it's not, I mean, Michael and I are not a duo. We're the remainders of what happened many, many years ago, still keeping going on that, in that kind of work.
There's also the question of a matter of instability is a very significant one, in that an archive presumably is something where you have a set of documents and you interrogate the documents to discover what was going on or some historical position is to a degree illustrated, narrated, evidenced, indexed, or whatever might. This work is unstable in the sense that there's bits of paper lying around in very beautiful vitrines in Barcelona, and the bits of paper don't know whether they're archival in one sense or another, or potentially works, and they might get out of there in some sort of at least not quite fanciful sense that they might escape from, as it were, their confinement in the vitrine as document. I mean, and this is to a degree built upon a number of issues that arose with our way of operating conceptual art. One thing is that there was no, unlike the sort of classic sort of American conceptual, like two lines readily assimilated, two lines, a kind of William Carlos Williams, writ small of American, a lot of American conceptual art. There was, in our activity, no limit to the length it might be in principle. This creates a very strange sort of object indeed, because it really involves an object which can only have a kind of existence in terms of its being transmitted from between people. At the same time, since that period also generated this strange kind of post-Duchampian dispensation. You had what we later called, but operated at the time, a kind of emergency conditional in relation to this work. It was art just in case it was theory, and it was theory just in case it was art. So it's unstable, and if you don't make archives of that kind of thing, not very easy.
I think maybe I should stop asking questions and ask if anyone here has a question.
You referred to structures such as the anagram and the archive that you have some relation to but don't stay within, as it were. And I was thinking also of the structure of mise en abîme, because in the Incidents in a Museum series, you have a kind of mise en abîme, except it's not a stable mise en abîme, where there's definitely a foreground, definitely wants a depth or a point of disappearance. Each surface comes out and sets the frame for the one around it. And in that sense, it's a little bit reminds me of something like a kind of real-time feedback loop, such as maybe Dan Graham set up in Present Continuous Pasts in that video thing. And so I'm thinking about this way of framing art by language, language by art, theory by art, art by theory, in some kind of way that you're constantly trying to kind of go into the mise en abîme and come outside of it again as well.
Well,
I mean, yeah. Okay, yes, we are. We do go inside the mise en abîme.
One
don't want to go the whole way.
One has to be a bit careful with. I mean, there's more, you know, more mise en abîme available than you know, I could possibly digest or process or whatever the word is. But I mean, yes, what you've just described is, you know, sort of falling through it and, or, you know, falling into it and as it were.
But it's a kind of chicken and egg mise en abîme. Is the chicken framing the egg? Is the egg framing the chicken?
An old friend of ours, a guy called Christian Slater, looked at all the paintings with the as it were, the mise en abîme in it, and then he looked at the drawings, which were just without any mise en abîme. He said the drawings are better.
Well, that's not strictly true. The whole concept is a kind of mise en abîme, because it's a fiction of presence
that's
in a place that you cannot be.
That's true. But he said they were better.
It's always seemed to me that the clue is in the title, that art and language is a route by which an artist could approach the question of their existence through language as a problem, which is why autonomy becomes a problem, and at the same time it becomes autonomy. So.
Yeah.
I couldn't quite hear it.
I thought that was kind of starting to get interesting.
Do you want to continue?
It'll only get interesting
You mean that was based on the stuff that we were talking about? We wanted the work to be autonomous, and we couldn't make it autonomous because of the language. Is that
no? I mean literally that the art. What you're saying is the artist can approach their existence as an artist through language as a problem. In other words, it's Spinozist in a certain way.
I don't know that I'm, or he, or anyone on this appeal is qualified to technically, you know, sophisticated in terms of, you know, logic and philosophy to address the problems of language to core. And certainly the problems of language for artists too cool either. At the same time, yes, we you know, the whole enterprise was to be founded on something that was very like that. Yes, that you know, the way we do our singling out determines what we single out, et cetera, et cetera, and all that. So, I mean, when Wiggins sort of semi-essentialism.
When Don Judd, many years ago, said, if someone says it's art, well, yeah, that was supposed to be a really clever remark, but if you're left with that remark, if someone says it's art, who's the someone? Who's the person who's doing the singling out? Well, you know, that's a question that you have to ask after that statement. So there was a... Am I not getting to your point?
No, no, you absolutely are, because what you're saying is, well, that would be a kind of route to self-satisfaction, whereas you're offering a problematic route, a difficult way to, well, coin a cliche.
The Don Judd remark, and this is a picture, this is yeah. really history, you couldn't but ask, you know, okay, who's doing it, what kind of language yes. are they saying it in? Those were the questions of so-called analytic
conceptualism. Judd is just a cartoon of the institutional theory.
Institutional theory.
Not really big.
Yeah, so I mean, just to get to what I think I was suggesting that you do valuably and usefully, it is to offer a certain route to autonomy through language as not a philosophical problem, but as a problem, literally as almost everyday usage problem. Mm. Mm. That's what I would say. My reference points here are Benthamite, so I won't carry on.
But the truth is, I mean, while I think the problem is an urgent one, I would say how we escape the kind of thermodynamic death of culture, as it were, and we'd probably have to escape it one way or another by restoring something which does the same sort of job as autonomy did for modernism, so to speak. I don't really know what it is and how to conceive it. It's a bit like those kind of, you know, it's an exactly sort of Bildung, you know, it's like talk of God. You go get these vague glimpses, and you know, it goes away. You know, the minute you think you get hold of it. But we know it's not to do with a rappel order. You know, you can't just go back to, you know, that. So there will have to be some way to incorporate that sort of infrastructural discursive dimension to it, and that's a linguistic point, in part a linguistic problem.
Okay. If there's one more, maybe we'd have time for one more.
No, we've nope. just said
okay. Then, Mike and Mel, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Thank you.